Ham Radio Now, episode 147. Heading back to the Dayton Hamvention. We've got some new stuff to look at Elecraft and TEN-TEC, both showing off some cute new products. And we'll get down there right away. I'm going to make a viewer very happy and not do a lot of other yammering here at the top of the show. I'll do some yammering at the end of the show. So for those of you that like to hear me yammer, I'll be back to do that. But first, we'll get to our interviews with only one interruption, and that is to remind you something you already know. Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. So if you enjoy the program and want to help us out financially, stop by the website, hamradionow.tv. Find Arvin there. His icon is prominently represented, and click on that. You can make a contribution through PayPal or a major credit card, or you can send me some cash or a check. Just got one in the mail today. Here's where you can go to find my address, my street address, and mail something to me if you want. All right. Back to the Dayton Hamvention. Let's do Elecraft first. I'll pretend to look at the monitor and play that interview. Hey, Eric, it is good to see you again here on Ham Radio Now, and we are at Dayton, and you've got yet another new product.
Well, great, Gary. I'm glad to be here, and of course, it's on Sunday now, so we're swinging down at the end of the show. So
yeah, I like to get you guys when you're tired and your resistance is low.
And our voice is still working barely, but we're doing well. So we've had a great show. It's been really busy here, so it's been fantastic. And new stuff, we've got a PX3 panadapter. That's a little tiny panadapter that goes on the on the KX3, and it's a full IQ input DSP FFT pan adapter that gives you up to 200 kilohertz of spectral display. And really, it's just like our P3 large pan adapter. It's Honey, I Shrunk the P3. It's only the same depth, about an inch and a half, as the KX3. Very lightweight, very portable, and you can basically plug it directly into the KX3 and get full spectral pan adapter display, also full point and click tuning on the system. And it allows you to pretty much see the whole band around you, so you can look at those pileups or find out where the DX station is, and basically very quickly get a visual representation of what's on the band.
How wide does it go?
Up to 200 kilohertz of spectrum, down to several kilohertz. So you can narrow down on PSK31 stations or see all the guys plus minus 100 kilohertz from you.
And I believe I'm seeing a waterfall on the bottom of it?
Yep. We can have a waterfall display or a full spectrum display. While you're looking at that, I'll push the button here. And I can go to full spectrum, so you can just see the spectrum by itself, or we can give you a split screen waterfall and spectrum, so you can see a history. The waterfall is really useful because if you have a very weak station on the band, you'll actually see maybe a very thin trace on the waterfall, but it's buried in the noise on the spectral display. You go, oh, there's somebody over there, and you can tune over and hear that station as they're weakly coming out of the floor, and maybe get stronger. So you'll pick up some really neat DX that way.
Battery operated?
No, it's not battery operated. We might do that in the future. There's room inside the case for some additional options. We have a VGA option, just like we have for the big P3 coming out for it. That also has a keyboard input, so you'll be able to do data modes with data display on it. So for portable RTTY PSK31 built into the KX3, you'll have that with this display.
Okay, so not being battery operated, you've stolen my opportunity for a joke, which is, when the backpackers go carry the radio, what do you recommend they leave out? Lunch or maybe their rain suit?
Well, that's a good question. I really don't know. But this runs on a fairly small battery, so what most people are doing right now is they're going to be using just a small external battery for it if they want to run battery operation.
Okay, so it will run on a battery. It just doesn't have an internal battery.
Exactly. No internal. It'll run with an external battery if no problem. And a lot of people that are running long operations, even though we have internal batteries on the KX3, bring along a lithium polymer or some small battery that has, you know, 5 amp hours of storage time or more, and that easily could power both of these.
Okay. Does it draw a lot of current?
No, not a lot at all. I don't have the total number with me, but I think it's under a couple hundred milliamps. So.
Okay, and what does this one sell for?
This sells for, if I remember correctly, $499 in the kit version, and I'd have to look at my price list. I've been staring at too many things here all day.
How much of a kit is it? No surface mount soldering, right?
It's no soldering at all, actually. It's a modular, just like our other K3 and KX3 kits, where you actually just mount the boards. We've pre-tested the boards and so on.
Screwdriver kit.
Yeah, screwdriver kit, absolutely, yeah.
Okay, and so so this price is again?
Oh, I'm sorry, $499 for the kit version, and for my PX3, if I can find my right side of the page here, it is $579 for the assembled version from the factory.
All right, so that's very cool. The backpack revolution is continuing and progressing, and like I say, you got to figure out whether you're going to leave home lunch or your rain jacket, you got to still take the antenna.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And we'll play with either with the auto tuner and the KX3. Of course, it'll play with a random wire or a buddy pole or anything out there. But you mentioned portal operation, which of course these are used for quite a bit, but actually even more get used for home operation. These are becoming home stations because of the high performance on the KX3. And with the PX3, KX3, and the KXPA 100 amplifier, you almost have a KX line, like our K line and the big stuff. And you have a full 100 watt integrated station here. It all talks to each other and they follow around and automatically auto-tune with the auto-tuner and the amplifier and so on. So
I don't even need a whole desk for that. This will do on the coffee table.
Yeah, this is a little tiny corner of your operation here. It fits really nice.
And still do the teletype and PSK31 right from the KX3?
Exactly. They're built into the radio, and as I mentioned, with the PX3, you can hook a USB keyboard up to the PX3 and do CW or RTTY PSK31 transmission, too.
Okay, and continuing on in the shrinking things domain, on the other side of the booth, you've got a shrunken version of the remote control for the K3?
Yeah, we have K3-0 we've sold for some time, which was a full-size like remote head panel for the K3, so you can control it over the internet with full real-time feel. We shrunk that down to almost the same depth as a KX3, about an inch and a half, 2 inches, the K30 Mini, which is what we sell now for that. And that interfaces either to remote rig boxes from Sweden that we sell over the internet for data and voice over IP to control a K3, but you have full real-time feel. Or actually, we have software from remotehams.com, which is free, one of our engineers wrote that works for me now, that provides both sides over PCs, and that panel plugs into that over USB. We have actually, out of the K30 Mini panel, either direct cable to the remote rig boxes or a USB connection with voice, sound card capability, and data that goes directly to a PC, and software on the PC you can get for free to do remote control that way.
Can the KX3 be operated as a remote?
Not currently. KX3 has some very basic remote capability for K3, maybe the VFO and the mode buttons. We don't really have a full implementation because the front panel is sufficiently different from the K3s that it doesn't map directly to it. And then we really just haven't had the time to do special software for that. So no, it's mostly the K30 Mini that does that right now.
I was thinking, you know, why bother? You're taking it with you, but you're saying more and more people are setting it up as a full home station, so they might want that someday.
Yeah, they could absolutely do that. The K30 Mini is so close to that people are doing that way right now, too. We've actually got a whole ecosystem of companies now that have built up. Have you seen the, like, remotehamradio.com, the guys that you can get timeshare on big stations around the world? They're using the K30. They're all K3s there and K30 Minis. For the control side. And
I'm not very familiar with it. I'm just, you know, sort of vaguely ringing a bell. So this is a service where you can and operate somebody, a station that's built for everybody to get together and operate remote?
Yeah, they basically have multi big stations, like monster stations all around the world that you can timeshare on for a fee. They actually, you know, charge for time on that. And you can now be the big DX station in Spain or the big station coming out of the Western U.S. or Eastern U.S. operating from your home over the internet with a K30. So the VFO buttons, everything's exactly the same, full CW, antenna rotor control, everything. And there's a number of people, of course, do that individually with their own stations with our stuff, but these people actually do it on remotehamradio.com as a service where you can do that. So if you can't get on the air with a station from where you are in a condo or antenna-restricted community, this is another way to get on the air.
It sounds like a bigger station than most of us would ever put together anyway.
Right, I think that's the attraction of it, is they're doing the big station.
So why are you promoting that? Because if somebody does that, they're not going to buy a radio, but they'll buy your remote.
Well, the remotes are using our radios, they're buying the K3. Believe me, it's all good for us. We like to see it out there everywhere, so it's good for us.
All right, well, thank you very much, Eric, and we'll see you at the next show.
Gary, we're looking forward to it. Thanks a lot.
All right, that's cute. TEN-TEC has just merged with the Alpha folks, RF Concepts, the folks that have been the Alpha amplifier company. So now that's going to be one big happy company. We're only going to get a few details about that. Mostly we're going to find out about a cute new radio that TEN-TEC is going to be having this summer. So back to Dayton, and let's talk to TEN-TEC. And I'm at TEN-TEC. Who am I talking to?
Hi, my name is Stan Brock. I'm running the sales department at TEN-TEC, and just glad to be here at Dayton showing all of our fine products again.
I'm starting as ham radio now. I'm starting to get press releases and announcements. People are discovering that we exist, and one of them came from you guys, something about a merger.
Yes, we did. We have a merger with RF Concepts and Alpha Amplifiers, so We are now having the Alpha Linear Amplifier line and TEN-TEC under the RF Concepts, and we're merged. And we're excited because the people that we're working with have been just excellent as far as you know, trying to make an easy transition into a unitary body for the benefit of amateur radio for all American-made products.
That is very good marketing stuff.
Yep.
My question is, what's in it for you guys? What's in it for Ham?
Well, we think that we're going to be able to increase the quickness of getting products out by being able to have double engineering capabilities. We will be using some of their capabilities that Alpha Linears have with circuit design and board design work. We'll be able to bring production up to a faster pace, be able to get more and newer products out at a quicker pace.
You have a toy to show me.
Exactly.
Tell me about the toy.
Well, we're talking about some fast and new products, and this is one of them. The Patriot Model 507 is a brand new product. Okay, is this, there we go. That gives you a little idea.
And what does it do?
Well, this is an open source, both sideband and CW transceiver. The it's a QRP radio. It operates between, say, 3 to 5 watts, depending on battery voltage. But it's just a fun little, actually a Maker Faire type of a radio. This is one of the newest things that TEN-TEC came up with here last year with the evolution of the Rebel transceiver. We introduced that at 4 Days in May. This was introduced at 4 Days in May for the this year's QRP presentation. And this particular product offers that capability for the person that likes to write their own software, change the features of the radio, add new items, add a digital display, put a keyer in it, all of those little things that you might want to add to a radio, tailor it to your own use and functionality. And this allows you to do that and with just the programming. Let me show you what it includes. This is a chipset, Uno 32 chipset right here. And this is all Arduino-type software programming that's used in this particular product. Just like the Rebel, has a tremendous amount of horsepower. And up above, you can see the header pins here, where you could actually add a shield to that and add other items to that particular product. With the mini USB port connection, you can connect that to your computer and do multiple programming with this, and it just allows you to make a real simple and easy connection to start your own programming skills and learn the different nuances of programming Arduino technology.
Well, now that's a good point, because programming can be daunting to get started with. That comes right out of the box. It's not a kit, right?
Right. We give you the basic platform. We give you a transceiver. We give you a 40 and 20 meter CW sideband transceiver. All the basic features, we give you a step tuning, we give you an RIT, your volume control, your selector and your function buttons and so forth. And from there, you can take it and do your own thing. So we give you the basics and, for instance, if you decide you'd like to change a few of the programs and modify the radio, and let's just say you really messed it up, well, you can take it, reprogram it with the program that we give you with it online, and you can just download it, reflash the radio, and you're back to the square one.
Okay, so you give people the base program to start with.
We do. We give you the base program. We'll have that published on our website. And also, there are many different user groups, a lot of Yahoo groups that are playing with these units, and they're doing different things with it, and they publish their software there. So a lot, it's all freeware. We just want you as a hobbyist to enjoy another feature of the hobby. And that's
so I'm seeing about half of the knobs and buttons and stuff that I need. There's mic control, the volume, RT, tuning, stuff like that, but no displays. So how
right.
do you find out what the radio is doing?
Well, we give you a radio that's set. When you first turn it on, it'll be set to a specific calling frequency, or for instance, 14.200. And then from there, each time you make, depending on the revolutions, the little light here on the TEN-TEC will flicker, so you can tell how many kilohertz you have traveled either up or down the band. Now that's just a beginning point. That just gives you a starting place, and you just kind of keep track of that. Now, from there, if you want to add a digital display, you can use a Mauser display or some of these others, and you can create your own digital display, put it either on the box, in the box, or on top of another shield, and add it to the unit from there.
How about tablet or phone operation? Is that either available or in the works? I suppose somebody could develop their own?
Tablet or phone, for instance, there you could do it with like a Bluetooth, for instance. Those are things that could be added to it.
I'm thinking of the software to drive it and show a display, stuff like that, easily on a phone.
Absolutely. Yes, you sure could. Absolutely.
That's not coming direct from you, at least not right away.
No, it won't be. The idea of this product is we give you the platform. You're buying the platform. We want you to develop those features, publish them, let other people experiment with them, see what it's like to do some of that programming yourself.
Okay, and if somebody makes that, it's available for everybody.
It's available for everyone. That's exactly correct.
Okay, that sounds cool. Is this available now?
This will be available in August, priced at $399. Availability sometime in August when we have all the parts in and are ready to begin assembly of the first production run.
All right. Well, good luck with that and the merger, and we'll see.
Exciting. Thank you very much.
Expect many more high-power signals coming out of TEN-TEC radios.
There you go. We're looking forward to it. Thank you much.
I was looking at some of the QRP message boards, and that radio seems to have attracted a lot of attention. And people were asking the same thing I did. How do you tell what frequency you're on? How do you get information out of it? So now we know, and you've got some work to do. You got to do a little bit of programming and pass it around to the rest of the community if that's one of your skills. So I want to talk about a few things here at the end of the show. The first is doing manufacturer interviews. I'm not a big fan of them. Now, the folks at Elecraft and the folks at Flex tend to, well, first of all, they don't mind when I shut them down in their marketing speak. You know, the blah, blah, blah marketing, okay, tell me something real. Greg is very good at deviating around that and getting his message out. And Eric is also very good at it. He doesn't do quite so much marketing speak to begin with. Maybe he's learned his lesson. I haven't watched his interviews with other people. But they aim pretty much at telling you what the equipment is going to do. And in any kind of interview like that, all that stuff comes at you a mile a minute. You have to slow things down and look at individual features and see if they're going to be something that you want to do. So those interviews are helpful because you get to see things and see somebody push buttons, but they don't really teach you what this stuff is going to do until you do a little bit more research on your own. You'll notice that there's nothing by the time we're done anyway, there's no product interviews at the big three from Japan, Icom, Yaesu, and Kenwood. The Yaesu guy, not a big fan of mine, and probably not invited in there. They didn't have anything new. They had the FTM 400 radio that I wrote the review for QST that will be coming up in a future issue, but not a totally new product. I think they were announcing a new version of the repeater that will do the analog and digital stuff. So nothing really new there. But again, I don't think I'd be totally welcome doing a program there. He's kind of unhappy with me right now. Icom, I get along with Ray pretty well. Also didn't have anything brand new. The newest product they've got is the 5100, the D-Star mobile radio. And that's been covered by a lot of other people. I punched some buttons on it. I've never had one to play with and a telephonic interruption. That's an edit. I just did there. And to make it not look like an edit, I went to a different camera. And then I told you that it was an edit, so you know anyway. Call from Jeff. Jeff is going to help me out with a program that we're going to do later on this evening that I think I may make a ham radio now show out of. I'm going to be a guest at a club meeting up in New York on Skype, like Bob Heil and Gordon West do, and even George over at Ham Nation and Amateur Logic, they're guests at lots of radio club meetings on Skype. And this is the first one that I'll do. Don't know why they asked me. Well, yeah, I do, because I'm a big ham radio television star. Anyway, so ICOM had the 5100. I punched the buttons on it a little bit. After having played with that Yaesu radio for a while, that color display that really kind of snaps out at you, I really liked that. And the 5100 looks kind of dull. Its display is not real high contrast. And normally when I walk up to a radio like that, I'm able to make it do a fair amount, especially if I'm a D-Star radio that I'm pretty familiar with. I could hardly make that the 5100 do anything. In fact, it was at the point where I was thinking that the radio was kind of hosed. And buttons I was pushing on the touchscreen and other buttons on the display or on around the perimeter didn't seem to do things for me. So maybe that one was kind of hosed. I wouldn't take my experience at that too seriously. I would like to play with that radio sometime. But I wasn't super impressed with the display. My 2820, which has been a very nice radio but getting kind of long in the tooth, has had one serious flaw that a lot of people have been upset with, and that is that the display is pretty low contrast. And when you're operating it in a car, even though it's big, and some of the numbers are really big, some of the data is not real big, and it can be really hard to see in daylight in the interior of a car. And that's also that's a problem for me, and I've got mine in the car mounted right heads up where I can see it very directly. And if you're looking at obliquely at all, that stuff tends to disappear. I don't know how the 5100 will do in that circumstance, but just from looking at it in the showroom at the Hamfest at ICOM's booth, didn't look very high contrast. A lot of other radios snap visually much better. And again, that Yaesu FTM400, it looked great. I ran it in the car some as well, and its display showed up in the car pretty well. So, I don't know. That 5100 seemed like a step backwards in terms of display. Everything else, probably a major leap forward in D-Star, but the 5100 will be a step back. I do have an interview coming up with Jim McClellan, one of the original D-Star guys from the K5T IT group, in Texas that I did the program Digital Voice for Amateur Radio, did that with him back in 2008, a couple hundred years ago. So that interview will be coming up, and we'll be talking D-Star. So ICOM will get some coverage. And Kenwood, there was nothing new there. And the Kenwood guy has been kind of iffy. Sometimes he seems friendly, and sometimes he doesn't. But he doesn't like talking on camera. If they had a really revolutionary new product, something they were just announcing brand new at Dayton, it would have tried a little bit harder. What I really focused on for this this Hamfest was hitting some of the folks that are displaying products at smaller booths scattered around the Hamfest that you might not otherwise encounter. And so after this program, we'll start looking at a few of those. And I've got some fan videos. I pointed the camera at fans. Did find somebody who was wearing a Ham Radio Now t-shirt. One guy. So that worked out actually better than I thought it would. And we're going to wrap up this series with some really cool stuff that some kids are doing. They're not hams, but they're building robotics. And it's not battle bots. It's robots that are in competition to do things. And they came to the Hamfest. They set up in a corner of one of the buildings and demonstrated their stuff. And we caught them at the very tail end of things. So we'll wrap up the program with them. Very interesting group of young people, high school age young folks. I was going to say young hams, but none of them were hams. But I told them they needed to get ham. Take it very seriously. Get ham licenses. It'll push you way farther in your career. Well, they did for me. It worked for me. What else? The Flex interview. I put up a notice on QRZ.com of the Flex interview. And also CQ. I did sort of a dual deal, announcing both the Flex and CQ. Nobody made a comment at all about CQ, but it got a lot of attention for the Flex stuff. As I'm looking at it now, 3,700 people have viewed that post. Not nearly as many have actually watched the videos, but the Flex video is approaching 1,000 views on YouTube. And 42 replies. And as somebody mentioned in one of those replies, they went far afield. It started to become what usually happens when somebody talks about Flex on QRZ.com. You got the SDR haters, may be a little bit too strong a word, not for some of them, but for many of them. You know, it's just I like radios with knobs on them, and I don't need any of those SDR, and I don't see what it does for me, which is fine. If you don't see any of that stuff, that's fine. And if you need to say that again on QRZ.com every time somebody says something about it, sure, go ahead. It's free country, free speech. Free speech. They're not taking your posts down unless you get personally nasty at somebody. And it took a while, but eventually somebody came on and said, well, that's your opinion, and I really love the software-defined radio stuff, and you know, I love the Flex and some of the other stuff that is out there now. Really appreciate how all of that works and the things that those radios do that none of the purely button-pushing radios can do. So you got folks on both sides. One thing that came out that I wasn't aware of, or I would have asked Greg about it, is that the software updates, the major software updates for Flex's, not the Power SDR, the thing that ran Flex until this 6000 series, but the what they call the Smart SDR, and I wish people would stop using the word smart in anything that has to do with technology. It's just so overused. And D-Star, the S in D-Star stands for smart. So yeah, stop using that, everybody. It's overused. The Smart SDR software that is behind the 6000 series is, your license comes when you buy the radio, but major updates will not be free. It'll be a couple of $100. Not sure how often major updates will come. Bug fixes and minor updates will still be free. And of course you update the radio by just downloading the software and loading it in. So, you know, that's easy. And as a lot of the Flex folks have said, and somebody criticized them for saying, that you download the software and you get a whole new radio, or you get features that weren't there before. You know, a whole new radio is kind of an embellishment, but features that weren't there before, significant features, operational things that it didn't do, or it now does better. So don't know how often it's going to be that major releases come out in Smart SDR. It's, somebody was saying it's going to be every year $200, and that's probably not true, but I don't know for sure. Next time I talk to Greg, I'll ask what he thinks the interval will be on major releases. And I don't know how long it's going to be before Flex comes out with another line, you know, a 7,000 or 8,000 series or something like that has totally new software. They may or may not. They may, you know, Smart SDR with a funding base to pay for the new development may stay their software for a long, long time. And every couple of years, $200 to update your radio. Quick to point out, a lot of people on the QRZ thread were quick to point out that you don't have to buy it. If you're happy with the way the radio is working, then it will keep working forever with the current version, and you don't have to pay another penny. Other people were doing the hams are cheap thing, and reminding you that software development is not easy. It's not cheap for the company, and if you want, as somebody put it, Flex can sell the radio for a reasonable price, and you all have your own definition of what a reasonable price is for a radio like that. But they don't have to artificially inflate the price of the radio as you are buying it to account for future software development. You buy the radio for the price they can sell the radio for, and you update the software as you want by paying what is not a horrible amount of money. $200 is not nothing. It's not $25, but it is not a horrible amount of money if they're going to offer something that you want. And once again, if they don't have something that you want in that software release, you don't have to buy it. Keep on using the software that you got. So those are some of those things that went on in the 40, how many, 47, no, 42 comments in the thread. So cool. Somebody pointed out that's more comments and more views than I've gotten in most announcements that I put on QRZ.com. And too bad, none of them had anything to do with the show after like the first one. Or even the first one. I don't think anybody actually commented on the show or the interview. And clearly, a lot of people had not watched the interview itself. They just went off on their tangent, as people on QRZ.com and the whole rest of the internet are wont to do. So that's it for this pair of interviews. And the phone call interrupted me was Jeff saying he's coming over to do this show for the radio club that we're talking to. So if they're amenable to it, I'll record that and stick that up as an episode. And we'll see if it's interesting or not. I will talk to them about doing a show and the other people who do shows and general ham radio media, because that's what I know about. I'll probably talk to him about digital stuff too, because that's kind of a pet interest of mine. Even though the only thing that I actually do digital is D-Star. Never actually run FreeDV. Never plugged it into the 756 Pro 3 back here. There is now a computer sitting next to the radio. It's the Wirecast computer that I'm using to record all this stuff. And no, I am not going to... Oops, wrong button. No, I am not going to put ham radio software on this. This is a single, a dedicated purpose media computer. It does Wirecast, it does Premiere Pro, Pro Tools, a couple of other media programs, but I will not be loading it up with ham radio software. So some other computer's got to show up here. I was wandering around Tiger Direct yesterday, buying a few odds and ends, and saw a lot of cool, pretty powerful Windows 8 laptops at not really huge prices. I can't really afford one right now, even the relatively cheap ones, and I probably wouldn't get the cheapest ones. I'd probably get, you know, something in the $800 to $1,200 range and, you know, get a fair amount of power and all that stuff. But my old laptop is still doing pretty good. It's about 3 years old. I just upgraded the RAM to 8 gigabytes, and that helped out a lot. It was kind of pushing the deal where it was paging a lot of stuff out of RAM when I'd have too many programs open at once. And so that sped things up a lot. That's one way to give new life to a laptop. It had 4 gigabytes, and that's kind of the minimum for it's running Windows 7. I am rambling on here, aren't I? Let's stop. Let's get ready for that radio club program, and then I'll continue working over the weekend to pump out some more of the stuff that we shot at Dayton and get that online. So for now, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. He's Arvin at hamradionow.tv, reminding you that if you like these programs and you haven't contributed lately or at all, that'd be a good idea from my point of view. Hamradionow.tv, stop by there and help us out. And that's it. Over and out.